So a couple weeks ago, I got to go sit with my five-year-old in preschool. And they were doing some activities where they were drawing the different colors of the new season. And I looked on some tables, and you know, some of the kids had, you know, all the blue colors, and someone had all the green colors. And you know, as kids and as, you know, even as adults, we kind of have our favorite color. So it got me thinking, you know, what is the favorite color of humans, and where does that come from? And where's the data to support this thing? So this was just from one of the, you know, standard websites you'd find if you search this on Google, where you find that, you know, the majority of people, seem to like blue as their favorite color. Red is, you know, also very popular. So one of the things that you will find when you start looking into this kind of data is you look at the sort of average favorite color. Now, what is the average favorite color here? So the average, what would be the favorite average color? So in this case, maybe you would, you know, if you sort of had the color wheel set up in a way that you could, you know, move the dial, and because blue and red sort of are predominant here in this particular data set, maybe you'd get purple. But what does that mean? If most of the people really like blue and most of the people like red, it sort of means nothing to say that the average favorite color is purple. So that's sort of a point I want to make about averages.
I'd say it was yellow-green if I was looking at wavelengths. But
that's true. I mean,
the color wheel has to do with your psychology. This is physics. Anyway,
that's right. That's right. So if you were looking at frequency, Carl's right there. If you looked at the frequency spectrum, you would have this particular order would tell you that it would probably be yellow. But as you can see, no one really likes yellow. So why, if you report it as average color being yellow, that would be kind of silly. But the point I'm trying to make is there are different data types. There's binary data types. There's categorical data types. There's numeric data types. There's all kinds of different data types. And if you use averages in a wrong way on these different data types, you're going to get yourself in a lot of trouble. And you'll see this a lot in the things that you read online. So imagine that I'm a Martian. And since cows keep landing in this class, you land into this marsh field. And you want to look at, let's say, the you find these Y chromosomes. And you want to look at the average number of Y chromosomes in the population. So what would you find? We know that males tend to have one.
Is it a dairy?
Sorry?
Is it a dairy?
Oh, good question. Yeah. That's
Sorry.
A good question. Yeah. So in that case, I mean,
biologist.
Yeah, that's a biologist question. For the 30 biologists in this room, I know that you should be able to answer that one. So if you've already sort of thought about what that answer would be in your head, let's say it's around, you would have, of Y chromosomes, you'd have 0.5 because there's, you know, females don't have this particular chromosome, males have one. So what is that supposed to mean? If you said that the average number of Y chromosomes is 1.5, what would it mean? Well, it's similar to the kinds of things that we see in the news reported all the time on average income. So if I had you guys raise, if I sort of had a chance, if we had the time, and we asked you what your average income is per year in this class, well, it'd be pretty depressing, at least in this class. But what would happen if we invited Bill Gates to our classroom? Given that he makes still, on average, be careful, $3.7 billion a year, at least that's the figures that I could find, a year. Then if, again, the Martian came in here and said, Jevin, tell me what the average income of your classroom is. I'd say, well, it's about $25 million per person.
That's Harvard Business School numbers.
Yeah, that's true. That is true. So as you can see, it's a misuse of averages. And because we wanted to start simple, we want you to start looking out for averages. When they're misused, and when they're distorted to tell the kind of story, and sometimes they're just misused because they're used improperly. Now, the good news is, if I was to ask Google what the mean income of Seattle was, this was pretty cool. Search engines are kind of smart. It told me, you didn't mean mean here. You meant median, which is correct in this case, because we have a highly skewed distribution. A more appropriate way of measuring this would be the median. And that's sort of become the norm in reporting income inequality. And Google knew that. So some of our technology fails, and some of it does pretty good. And I'm not saying just Google always does well, because Google fails on this a lot. But in this case, Google helps you out and sort of notices that. So if you were to look at the median income of Seattle compared to other cities, or you wanted to look at the average income of Seattle, you better run into a website like this, or a page like this, which did come recently from the Seattle Times back in the fall. They were comparing different cities' median income rather than the mean income, because we have these highly, we have some of the richest people in the world that live in the city. You can see that you can compare different regions. This is how we should sort of use averages. On the first day of class, when I was sort of bragging about our website and Carl called bullshit on me, that was a place that I could have misused an average too. We had this burst of activity on the first day in the number of users. And from then, it sort of dropped down to around 3,000 users a day. But that first day, you know, we had 30,000 some odd users. Now, I could have said, well, the average number of users over the last several months has been, you know, 5,000 users per day. When in fact, if you look, the most common value, is not even near that value. And even if you look at the median value, it's not near that value. So just the misuse of averages. It sounds so simple. You know, you learned averages in middle school, I'm sure. But they're still misused today by top newspapers around the country, even misused in the scientific literature. So here's some cautionary notes. So this class is supposed to sort of be, we try to give examples, but then just here's a bullet list of cautionary things on averages. Be careful. When an average is reported, the first thing you should be asking, is it a mean that they're talking about? Is it a median? Or is it a mode? Simple question. What does the underlying distribution look like? What does the data look like? Is it positively skewed? Is it negatively skewed? Is it a Gaussian distribution? Are there extreme values? Of all the things right here, this is the one that will make you smart in the boardroom when your boss has you come in and one of your colleagues reports some average or does some kind of statistical analysis and there's a huge outlier in the data. You can say, well, let's remove that outlier and then see what happens. And you'll become super smart and you'll get a raise. So look here also at the data types. You can't use means in the same way from one data type to the next. This is misused all the time. It's a little bit like the color example, and it's like the Y chromosome example. So here's one way that I think about data. A lot of times what's useful for me when I think about data, I use physical models. I use kinematics as a way of understanding where these different moments are in the data. Imagine we have sort of just collected data on all the housing prices in Seattle. And as you would expect, a lot of the houses, you know, are around, let's say, 250, 300,000, the majority of them. Then you have the houses, they're more and more expensive. This is a bar graph, so these represent frequency of each one of these different bins. And then you have, you know, Bill Gates and Paul Allen's house over here. In that case, which of these boxes is your mean and median? That should just be automatic. Which one is the mean and which one is the median, given this skewed distribution? Now, if you don't have an answer in your head right away and you have to think about it, that's OK. But that's the sort of task I want you to go out of here with, is that you should be able to answer that question pretty quickly, because you're going to start seeing data more and more. And if you at least know where the mean and median is, that will help you. So for those that guess the median is in the first box, you're right. The median is that value that's the middle value. If you ordered all the values, that is the value that's the middle value, half of on the left, half of on the right. And in that case, it would be shifted a little bit to the left in this skewed distribution. Now, a normal distribution, it's right in the same place. A perfectly symmetrical distribution would be in the same place as the mean. Your mean would be here. Now, here's my next question for you. Just these quick little quizzes. We're trying to give you feedback on things that you should know really quickly. And if not, then walk out today knowing this. What would happen if we added Bill Gates' house? Which of these would shift to the right? Which one would stay the same? Yeah, exactly. The median would stay the same here. The mean would shift to the right. Now, here's one of the physical sort of models that I use to looking at how things, the differences in what these measurements are. So when I think of a mean, I think of a center of mass. So it's the sort of fulcrum holding up, balancing. Imagine this is a stick here. There are these blocks of the same size, because these are counts. Blocks of the same size weigh the same. So you can imagine you're in my son's preschool class, and you put a fulcrum, you put blocks on the side. There's more block, heavier blocks, proportional to size, they're on this side. The mean is sort of the center of mass, so it balances, it should balance perfectly even. But the median, on the other hand, will tilt as extreme values are added to that distribution. So let's walk that, let's see that back again. So any of these really complicated statistical metrics that you'll hear, and averages aren't complicated, but you still need them, sort of these different models for looking at data quickly and sort of assessing whether what you're seeing. So this is one of the things we want to get to. Now, this is a quick summary of just what I was showing. You'll if you see different, there's lots of different kinds of distributions, but here are some of the three most common ones that you'll see. These are three common ones. You have the sort of normal distribution where the mean and median are right in the same place. Negatively skewed distribution where the median is on sort of on the weighted side, and on this side it's symmetrical, and you have the median closer to the hump in the distribution. Things that you would see in normal distribution, heights, blood pressure, all sorts of things. If we had time, I'd force you to think about the different kinds of data that would find themselves in these different classes. Something like a negative skewed distribution would be age of death. So you get it skewed to the right of the age. So if you took all the ages of death in the United States, it would be skewed to the right. It would be negatively skewed. Like grades, as we get grade inflation, we get skewness in our grades. If you look at the university grades, which we have in our system, things that are that are positively skewed, you have a lot of things that are positively skewed. Income distribution is one. Twitter popularity. This is something you would find lots and lots of examples. So here I'm just sort of reemphasizing what the importance of those outliers. We'll talk a little bit more about this as we go through the class, but just sort of have this imprinted in your head. When you look at a distribution, you should be questioning what the outliers are doing to your analysis and to your conclusions. You see this stuff all the time in Cooking the Books, Enron, a lot of these sort of those crooked CEOs that have been caught. They are typically doing things like, for example, if I was the CEO and I was reporting earnings month by month, so this was a reported earnings month by month, I'm getting 5K, 5K, 5K. And then the most recent month, I get a 1,000K, and then I'm supposed to go meet with my board. And they ask me, they say, so what's your how are you doing? And I say, oh, we're doing great. We're pulling in about 130K on average per month. That's the data. I'm not lying. I mean, that is the data if I was using the average like I wanted to. But if I use the median or I use the mean, the board probably wouldn't like the fact that I was only bringing in 5K. But I can cook it however I want, because maybe in this last month I got an infusion of cash from VCs, and I can make it look however I want. So when you these crooked CEOs that have been caught, are typically doing things like cooking the book. And sometimes it's not even the data is real. It's just how they're cooking up the metric. Now, there are all different ways. Again, this gets back to the color. It's the sort of misuse of data types when people try to take qualitative data, convert it to quantitative data, and then use the same kinds of metrics to do the same kinds of analysis that you would in the quantitative sphere. So, looking at sort of like the hotness of chilies or the color of chilies or how much you like chilies, using a Likert scale or all the different ways in which we can try to quantify things that typically are more qualitative, and then the ways in which you can misuse those metrics are something to be aware of. One thing that's sort of just as important as sort of just the misuse of some of these simple metrics and statistics is how the information is sampled. So this is the class. This is actually you. I sort of graded out so no one will know who it is. And actually, it's been there's a mosaic, so there's much more students here in this sample. But let's imagine that I wanted to figure out whether you guys were understanding the content and I was to do some sort of test, but I could only sample 10 of you. How would I do that? One way is I could sort of just randomly throw darts up there and then choose people that way. I could try to make sure that I got a sample of some seniors, some juniors, some graduate students. I know there's like a ton of different majors out there. I could try to do different things there. But the sampling scheme will obviously really, really affect your results. And so we'll keep hitting that over and over and over. The thing, how you do your sampling, trying to get away from just convenient sampling is something really important. So here's a sort of take home again. Think about whether you're using median, median mode. What is the underlying data? What does it look like? Beware of extreme values, and beware of the data types.